Empower the use of open source with software composition analysis from Revenera.
All right. Hello. Thank you. And welcome to our third and final podcast in our cybersecurity awareness series. This podcast is titled Managing a Security Incident in an Application. Once again, I'm Kendra Morton. I'm Product Marketing Manager at Revenera. And we are joined once again by our expert guest, Alex Rybak. He's Director of Product Management at Revenera as well. So Alex, are you ready for round three?
I'm ready for round three. Let's get to it.
All right. Let's do it. All right. So in our first episode, we gave listeners some concrete steps into launching a successful security program. And then in our second podcast, we talked about and discussed the importance of really integrating security with a software composition analysis solution. In this episode, Alex is going to share some practical advice to managing a security issue when one comes in and how to get ahead of future security problems. So Alex, you know, that call comes in, that dreaded call. There's a security breach in an application. Are there some best practices companies should follow to really handle an incident?
Yes, for sure. And the main thing is you don't want this to be a fire drill. So the more you prepare for it, the better. I think there's kind of a false sense that if you do everything we talked about in the last couple podcasts, that you will never get the call. Chances are you will get the call. So be prepared. I would say as much as you can do proactively to kind of role play this happening, that'd be great. If you can't, the first time will be a trial by fire and you retroactively figure out how you're going to do better next time. And that's okay. It happens. So I would say first thing is establish a response team. It could be one person. It could be 20 people. It just depends on the scale of your company, the complexity of your product, whatever is appropriate for you. I know on our end, it's typically somebody who works with a customer. So there would be a customer success manager involved. I would be involved from cybersecurity team. There may be other people from cybersecurity. You typically will have somebody from engineering involved because there may be specific questions on how a vulnerable component is being used. So it's good to have that expertise on the call. And then depending on the situation, there may be somebody from sales or services or whoever's managing the customer that's reporting it. But it can also be reported by an outside researcher. It doesn't necessarily have to be a customer reporting it.
So what I would about say legal? Sorry, I'm going to interrupt. I apologize. What
about legal? Legal, from my experience, has been more of a consultant on how to respond to make sure that we're compliant on our contracts, things like that. But definitely your CISO may be involved, your CTO may be involved. It just depends on kind of how egregious the issue is, if it's localized to a specific product or function, or if it's, you know, an issue in your data center. So this definitely will vary by what happens. So there's a term people should know called PCIRT. It's the Product Security Incident Response Team. This is kind of a fancy way of saying who are the folks that will take the call. And you definitely want someone who has been on past calls like this, because there is ideally a process you follow. But you definitely want expertise for whatever application is impacted, because that's where the questions are naturally going to go. So when we talk about a process, so what does a typical PCIRT process looks like? So number one, you likely already have something in place through your CISO. You likely have a formal way of somebody filing an issue, right? We have a web page where people can go and file a security issue with our products. Maybe you have an email address. Maybe it comes in from the field through support or through your customer success managers, but some way an issue comes to be. So typically the first step is acknowledging the inbound security issue, that yes, we heard you, we understand what you're talking about, let's set up a conversation. Then the next thing that typically happens is you review the issue with a reporting party, and it's kind of a needs analysis information gathering session, right? You're trying to understand the context of where the exploitation occurred, which products are impacted, what were they doing, what is the consequence of the issue, and you get as much information as you can so you can have then a conversation with your team to try to reproduce this problem. So you start with acknowledging, then you have typically a review, and then you try to reproduce the issue internally. Then the next thing that you would want to do, and this is where it just depends on how proactive you've been. If you've been doing your security scanning, you can compare your existing results with what somebody is reporting in the field. If you haven't done your scanning, then you're likely going to scramble to try to do some scanning and testing, and then you need to reconcile your findings with what's being reported. And this could be pretty challenging and could take some time, because if this is an exploitation based on an open source component, you will have a different remediation path than if it is code in your product that your team wrote. So it's important to be able to understand where the vulnerability is coming from, who's responsible for it, who's going to fix it, are you going to patch, are you going to change code, and how is it being exploited, right? Is it an easy exploit? Is it fairly complicated? If your product is running behind a customer's firewall, maybe there's a level of protection that other customers who run on a hosted version don't have. So all those things need to be discussed and understood. The next typical step is developing some sort of remediation plan, right? And this is what you're going to then communicate back to whoever reported it on. We expect to have a fix in a month or in a week or in a day or however long it takes, and set the right expectation with your customers. Now, if something is reported to you, this is where legal typically gets involved, is what is your obligation to your customers? Do you have to make them aware that somebody has reported a security problem? Do you make them aware right away? Do you make them aware once there's a fix? It just varies, right? There's no hard rule there. So this is where legal and security will have to have a kind of a meeting of the minds on what is the best process to, you know, uphold your obligations in your contracts, but also not expose your company more than it needs to be with information on how to exploit it until there's a fix there. Then typically there's a cycle to make the fix, whatever that is, that may be. And then probably the most important step is kind of do a retrospective at the end, update your security policies, update your testing policies, update your response process as needed to do better next time around.
Okay, very good. So that's
all on the process side. Now, I can certainly get into, you know, what are some of the remediation options, but, you know, I'll give you a shot to kind of come back with something.
Okay, so that's dealing with the here and now, right? Yes. So that's that call that comes in today. Are there possible preventative measures that companies can take to maybe mitigate future issues early, being proactive again, right?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. You know, number one, train your team. It's always more difficult if folks don't understand that, you know, they're ultimately responsible for security. Everybody should be. So kind of goes back to what we talked about in the last two podcasts, was train your team, set them up for success, explain why they have to do this, make it part of the culture. Don't make this a fire drill for somebody who is working on a new feature and suddenly they have to switch context and go hunt a bug due to a security report. So, you know, your team needs to understand that these things may happen. They need to understand that they may be asked to jump in with urgency to try to resolve this and understand kind of what's going on. If this happens to be a hosted solution, you may have to have a containment strategy, right? You may not be able to wait for a fix. So you may have to bring the product down. You may have to turn off a feature. Engineering are going to be the ones who are going to do that. So they need to understand kind of their, you know, they're on call if something goes wrong, and they need to be prepared to be able to take that call. Certainly running SAS, DAST, SCA early off and continuously will help, right? At least it will not be a surprise if there's an issue found. You don't want to be kind of behind the eight ball if somebody calls in and says, we found a problem. You don't want to then go have to spend a month doing all your scans to be able to reproduce it and understand that, yes, we do have a problem. So the more you're on top of all your scans and all your pen tests and any sort of external security reviews, you can go look at your results and say, okay, yes, I understand how that could have happened. And we have a vector on how to go ahead and get it fixed. And then be consistent, right? You want to track progress, both good and bad. You want to report upwards in your company and downwards. Everybody needs to know kind of what we did, what worked, what didn't work. How do we do it better in the future? And then as you go through these, hopefully not too often, but as you go through more and more of these types of issues, you should have a more refined process and it should be more intuitive.
Okay. So, and we kind of skipped over the mitigation a little bit, but is there a bucket of mitigation that we can, steps that we can talk about, or maybe we need to take that to a new podcast? That's an idea.
You know, I'll do a quick version of it, but certainly this could be an entire session itself. So yes, there's lots of mitigation, containment, and remediation options. Again, it just depends on the nature of the issue. It could be a vulnerability that's fixed by a configuration change. It could be one where you have to upgrade to a more recent version of a component. It could be one that you have to go and rewrite code for a year because it's at the heart of your product. It just depends. So typically, again, if this is something that you're hosting, the first thing is going to be, depending on the severity of the exploit, some sort of containment strategy, right? How do we limit further damage? So number one is, can we lock something down, right, to prevent anybody else from exploiting it? And can we somehow limit the consequence of any existing exploitations? So if certain user account information has been leaked, can we lock down other accounts? If there's a particular function that exposes any sort of privacy data, can that function be closed down, or do we have to bring the entire thing down? And we've seen cases of all these in the past. The other thing that's important to understand is, where is the problem, right? Is it in your code? Is it in somebody else's third-party or open source code that you're using? Can you fix it, right? Can you upgrade the component? Is there an upgrade available? Maybe you're on the latest version and there's a new vulnerability, so now you're kind of playing the waiting game till somebody patches it. In that case, if there is no fix, you can try to reach out to the author to try to, you know, put some urgency on them. If that doesn't work, you can try to fix it yourself and then optionally contribute the fix back based on your own open source policies. You could try swapping it out for a different component. That's always an option, but that typically is not a quick option. You can remove it and write your own code, right? Or you can try to write code to work around the exploitation. Sometimes the way that you use a component, the way you call into it, the data that's passed back and forth, maybe there's an alternative way to integrate their component, and you can write some defensive code on your end to at least avoid that particular issue. So all these are available, all these are on the table. Chances are your engineering team already has some contingency plans documented. So you want to refer to those, you want to look at your security policies on how you fix certain type of exploits. And again, always kind of rinse, repeat, refine, and try to make it better for next time around.
Yeah, it sounds like some of that is very situational dependent, as well as whatever is in your existing security policy. So
yes, good to
be up to date on that. Okay, all right. So we've covered a lot when we're talking about application security in these last few episodes of this series. So what are some of the top of mind takeaways that you think our listeners should really walk away with?
Yeah, I'd say number one is just be reasonable. If your goal is to end up with zero vulnerabilities, you'll never achieve it. So have kind of a common sense and pragmatic and reasonable approach. Don't try to boil the ocean. Don't try to fix every security problem in one shot. Definitely invest time in training. Invest time in assessing where your products are vulnerable, depending on how they work, who uses them, how they're deployed. Focus on things that cause you the most risk or the most harm to your customers. Make a top three, burn down the three, you know, number four becomes number one, and just kind of keep going, right? It is definitely a marathon. It's a continuous ongoing process. Don't try to fix everything in one release. You're going to break something else. So treat it like kind of a continuous improvement process, right? That's definitely what you want. I'll repeat again, invest in your team, right? It's really hard to hold engineers accountable if they've never been trained or told that they're responsible for this work. So don't put them in a defensive kind of lose-lose situation. Explain that it's part of the job. Explain that there's adequate training provided, and if not, provide training. There's lots of companies out there that offer kind of more game-based training. There's competitions, there's hackathons, there's, you know, who in your team can first solve a security problem. So there's more engaging ways to do the training as opposed to just go take a course and then try to apply it. So definitely look into those. But make sure that your team understands that they're on the hook for supporting this and that they are properly trained and enabled to fix these problems quickly, because time is going to always be of the essence. And then, you know, don't forget about the element of time. When you talk about open source vulnerabilities, things don't get better with time. So even if you have older third-party components or open source components that don't have vulnerabilities, make sure you're not too far back from latest patches. Make sure your patches are applied. Make sure that your bill of material is up to date and that it continuously is refined and complete. Right? That's the best way to avoid issues, is to know what you're using, know where it is. And if a problem does come in, you know where to go to do remediation work and to fix it.
Very good. I like that idea of training, first of all, right? Because it kind of all will start and stop right there with the developer. So give the developer the training they need. And then I also really like the idea of not boiling the ocean. I think that's why having mitigation strategies right in place and at your fingertips is so important. So very good. Good stuff. All right. Thank you, Alex. Fantastic.
Thank you.
All right, good. So that does it really for our cybersecurity awareness series. It won't be our last. We've already got a few ideas that we're walking away with here for new podcasts. So check back in the future. We'll be covering issues and best practices around software composition analysis, around certainly cybersecurity awareness, around protecting and securing the software supply chain, SCA and security and technical due diligence around mergers and acquisitions. So there's a lot there to unpack. So be sure to check back with us. All right. Thank you so much for joining us, and we hope to see you again soon.
Empower the use of open source with software composition analysis from Revenera.